So, good morning, everyone. Welcome. Special welcome to my wife again. I just want to welcome her back to church. And Amy, the latest addition, who's causing us some sleep deprivation, but it's okay. So we've been talking about restoration, and it's something that God has been doing since Genesis, right up to today, and He's continuing tomorrow. He was at it yesterday. He's busy today with it, up until Jesus comes. Up until we're united with Christ, this process of restoration is continuing. And it's so exciting for us to look at it. And so I prayed about it, and God laid, He gave me three incidents or examples in the Bible where restoration took place. Each one of them a little bit different. I don't know why these three, but I just wanted to be obedient to it. And we're going to look at it. But first, before we get there, just the word restoration. There's a basic understanding that we need to have of the word, the English word restoration. In the regular dictionary, it's the use. The word points out to an action which is returning something to its original owner. If you had a car and it got borrowed without permission, and you phoned the police and they got hold of it again, it gets restored to you. Okay? To its original owner or condition. So it might be that they had to run it off the road and it ended up on its roof and the panel beater had to fix it up, but now the condition is restored. And then there's a restoration to the purpose of it. That car had a purpose. You took your kids to school, you went to work with it, but now some axles are bent or the shocks are gone and the mechanic has to replace it for you to be able to use it for the purpose that it was there again. So there's a complete restoration that took place to its original condition, purpose, and all of that. So let's look at these three examples. The first one we're going to look at today, if we can read in the Word of God, because the restoration that God does is a little bit different. We want to look at that. In Job 42, verse 10, to 12, we read together, it says, "After Job had prayed for his friends, the Lord restored his fortunes and gave him twice as much as he had before. All his brothers and sisters and everyone who had known him before came and ate with him in his house. They comforted and consoled him over all the trouble the Lord had brought on him, and each one gave him a piece of silver and a golden ring." Verse 12, "The Lord blessed the latter part of Job's life more than the former part. He had 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels, 1,000 yoke of oxen, and 1,000 donkeys." So just more or less in today's term of what it's worth, I looked it up and they say it's between 50 to 60 million US dollars. So that's pretty good, eh? But these few verses leave the prosperity preachers with their hands in their hair, because they look at this and they want the benefit of the restoration Job experienced, but they don't want to endure any of the suffering he went through. So what to do with that? So let's remember the initial conversation there was. It was between God and Satan. It said Satan roamed the earth and did what he does. He came to God, and if we read in Job 1 verse 8, it says, "Then the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on earth. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil.'" And Satan said, "Yes, yeah, that's true. But it's because you've hedged him in, you've protected him. It's because of what he receives from you that he fears you. It's because of all of that that he loves you." And God permitted Satan to take away all of that except his life, even his health. We see he had sores, terrible sores all over his body. I can imagine he couldn't sleep with it. It hurts so much. And we've been speaking lately about, we've also been speaking about love. Last time we touched on agape love, that love, unconditional love. It doesn't matter what it is that I experience, what I get, but it's an unconditional love. So before we look at the restoration that happened, let's just ask ourselves this question. My obedience towards God, my fear of God, my love of God, is it conditional or is it unconditional? Does my situation and where I find myself, does it determine how I love God? Because then there's something just out there. Can we keep on believing that God is good and righteous even when everything turns south? But then we also want to quickly look at Job's friends. They also call them the comforters and counselors. There are lessons in their reactions for us. And initially we look at them and they feel so sorry for him and they just sit there with him in silence. They just sit there with him. So they start off on the right path. When we need to comfort someone, there's nothing better we can do than just to be with them. Just to be with them. Just to let someone know, listen, I'm here with you. I don't know what to say, but I'm here, man. I'm praying for you. I'm praying with you. I'm here for you. We're so quick to want to speak. So they started off in the right way, and they sat there looking at Job. And I think after a few days, what he went through was so terrible that it impacted them. They started feeling anxious about their understanding of God and how it might impact their life. They started feeling really uncomfortable. So they wanted to sort themselves out, and to do that, they wanted to justify why Job was in the situation he was in. So let me find something to justify why he's there where he's at. And they went on this hunt for sin in Job's life. And they went all over. They covered everything. Job, you need to confess, my brother, confess. There's secret sin in your life. That's why, that's why the wrath of God is on you. Job, repent. Repent, brother. Job, when last did you read your Bible? Are you still praying? When last did you pray in your tongues? Just using my own words. But we do that. We find ourselves, we look into a situation, and we're so quick to judge or put our judgment in that situation and to try and figure it out with our understanding, our logic. Find something in it. We're so quick to look in on a situation and take second-hand offense in it. Take sides in it. We don't understand it. It's like adding petrol to a fire that's got nothing to do with me. And in the end, I get burned as well. What we see is that their theology and their understanding of God was wrong. God himself pointed it out. If we read in Job 42 verse 7, it says, after the Lord had said these things to Job, remember God did put Job in his place saying, Job, do you think you understand me? Do you think you can comprehend who I am, the fullness of who I am? God's got such a sense of humor. He uses the hippo and the crocodile as examples, and he says, Job, these absolutely crazy-looking animals, do you even understand them? God is so amazing. I think if we could just see his sense of humor and things as well, we'd have so much fun. But anyway, God said, he said to Eliphaz the Temanite, I'm angry with you and your friends because you have not spoken the truth about me. We are so quick to think we understand God. We have the truth. We want to give the truth. Come on. As my servant Job has, verse 8. So now take 7 bulls and 7 rams and go to my servant Job and sacrifice a burnt offering for yourselves. My servant Job will pray for you, and I will accept his prayer and not deal with you according to your folly. There's a further bit of God's humor in this. you have not spoken the truth about me. So, we are all friends here, aren't we? I have friends here. I want to be a friend to people. But what type of friends are we? When giving advice, we want to be sure it's according to Scripture and by the unctioning of the Holy Spirit, not from myself. When we have friends in grief with great loss, they need to experience the love and compassion of God. We need to reflect who God is, a God of restoration, a God of love, of compassion. Even if the situation they find themselves in might be because of their own stuff, they need to, what they experience needs to be a reflection of Christ and of God. Nothing else. Being slow to speak and quick to listen. Why is it that we say, yes, speak to me, I'll listen to you, but when you're done, I'll tell you what the truth is. Or is it just me? Huh? Do you do that as well? They were proud and thought of themselves to be more righteous than Job because their own situation and circumstance was better. And we know it. We know we can't judge others around us because of our circumstance being better. But subconsciously it happens. You look at someone in trouble, you think, I wonder what you did. Huh? Yeah. Yes, and I agree. Some things, and the word of God is clear, some things is because of a consequence of our own actions. If I'm a follower of Christ, and I consciously and willfully choose to remain in sin, it's like painting a big target on my back for the enemy. That's what it is. It's like slapping a lion on its bum and thinking I'm not going to get clapped or devoured. It's just stupid. There are consequences to when we choose to willfully be in sin. But some trouble come our way because God said it will happen. Life is unfair. We live in a fallen world. We are not exempt from the storms in the world. What happens in the Ukraine and Russia, it impacts us, even us, the children of God. When COVID hit, everyone got COVID. Even the Christians got COVID. They weren't exempt from it. But there's a difference. God gives us the ability to have peace in the midst of that storm, to be able to endure it, to keep our peace, to have His joy in the midst of that storm. And I agree, Scripture is clear. We will step on snakes and scorpions, we'll drink poison and it will not harm us, but it's because of His grace. It's because of His enabling me to be able to go through it. It's not because I'm the man. It's not because I name it and I claim it. It's because of His grace. He enables me. And I should just be thankful. Yeah. John 16:33, it says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I've overcome the world. Trouble in the new covenant. Yes, even Jesus said, we'll have trouble. Trouble? But I thought that preacher that I got saved, he said, no, from now on, it will be sunshine and roses. It will be ice cream on the beach. But unfortunately, it's not true, eh? Some things God allows because He can see beyond the year now. He can see where we cannot see. His ways are beyond ours. His thoughts are above ours. He knows so much more towards the future and what He's busy with this process that we're looking at of restoration. Some things God allows because the final outcome will be a restoration beyond our greatest desire. And it will glorify Him. See, when it's so amazing that it couldn't have been us, it glorifies God. And He will allow sometimes for a season of storms and trouble so that when the restoration comes, it glorifies Him. All of God's restoration points to Him. We are just the lucky ones to sometimes enjoy the benefit of it. That's all it is. Back to restoration. God's restoration goes far beyond just replacing Job's former things. God's restoration for Job is exponential when we look at it. Far above his greatest thoughts or desires. But it is interesting that it says he was restored after he prayed for his friends. It's like there was this testing of just Job's loyalty, his obedience, his fear of God, his love of God. And that was pretty solid. And then the next one was the outward one. But those who were actually harassing you, they call them the comforters, but I don't think they were comforting. They were harassing him. They were like the enemy almost. God says, but you pray for them and I'll forgive them. And remember, Job wasn't aware of the conversation between God and Satan. He wasn't aware of what was going on. He just had this terrible circumstances he was in. And at that stage, God said, pray for them. So he didn't know what was coming afterwards, but he was obedient in praying for them. Praying for them. Matthew 5:44 says, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. We thought it was only a New Testament command. Job had to love and pray for those who persecuted him. And I want to say today that some of the greatest persecution we sometimes find is even within the church. It's amongst us. Preachers persecute each other. That guy is off the rails. Worshippers persecute each other. We do it with our mouths, with our words, our actions. But I want to make a stand today. And with us being in this month of restoration, I want to say that I trust God for complete restoration in the individual, in this season, but also in the body of Christ. For us, as all nations, that there's a process of restoration happening. We preached on unity 2-3 months ago. I think it's all part of it. God's restoring us. God's restoring us. But it's beyond just us. There's a restoration of the church in the world, worldwide. God looks far beyond just me. He sees there's a much greater thing that he is at work with. And I just want to say, I stand on that. I trust that that is what I'm busy seeing. And I'd like all of you to step out with me and to say, I trust this is what God is doing, this thing of restoration. So as we move on, just with regards to the restoration of Job, restoration is in God's hands. He determines what it looks like. He determines the timing and the process. Will we faithfully continue to serve and love the Lord in the process, even when the going gets tough? Will we continue to love and pray for those around us, even those who persecute us? Will we endure and suffer well when God permits a temporary situation of testing? Everything's temporary on earth, because there comes a time we're going to be reunited with Christ. So whether it happens now or when I'm reunited with him, it's going to be temporary. And I heard someone say, will you suffer well? And I thought, wow, this is hectic. This is so heavy. But it's true. We are his children. He enables us to go through seasons of distress with a big smile on our face, not because I'm acting it, but because of this relationship. And I'm completely fulfilled in him. Completely. And therefore, I'm at peace. And I've got joy. That's part of the testimony that we're supposed to be. So the next one, if we can read together in Psalm 105 from verse 16. It says, he called down famine on the land and destroyed all their supplies of food. And he sent a man before them, Joseph, sold as a slave. They bruised his feet with shackles. His neck was put in irons till what he foretold came to pass, till the word of the Lord proved him true. Some translations say tested. The king sent and released him. The ruler of people set him free He made him master of his household, ruler over all he possessed, to instruct his princes as he pleased and teach his elders wisdom. And if we can read then from Genesis 50, from verse 18 to 21. It says, but Joseph said to them, says verse 18, his brothers then came and threw themselves down before him. We are your slaves, they said. But Joseph said to them, don't be afraid. Am I in the place of God? Am I God that you should do this now? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children. And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. See, this biblical definition of the word restoration has got greater connotations that go above and beyond the typical everyday use of the word. Repeatedly through the Bible, we see God blessing people for enduring in their faith, their hardships, by making up for their losses and giving them more than they previously had before. So in this instance, God allows for a young, arrogant, immature man to go through this time of distress, of abandonment from his family, a time of shaping and testing, until he fitted that dream, until his character fitted that dream, until his maturity fitted the purpose God had for him, until he was a man of integrity, maturity, full of wisdom, enduring in faithfulness to God. Then God brought exponential restoration to him. But it wasn't just about him. It's Joseph's story, and he's almost the hero of the story. But God was as concerned about his family as he was about Joseph. So it was this restoration within Joseph. But in the end, it was restoration of a family, of a nation, and providing for nations that God was at work with. You know, sometimes it's like we've got this little pipe. We take a word, restoration, and we look at it through this thing, and I look at it and I see Udo. And now I say, and I only speak to Udo, I speak about Udo, I see Udo, until God takes it away. And we start seeing, instead of just seeing this one empty chair, I see 300 in this congregation. And then I see another 2.5 million in this country. And I see Africa and I see the world. And suddenly, I realize that I can fill that seat, but I can only fill that one seat. But there's so much more. And I am not enough for that. And I have to surrender unto God with this process, the thing that he's doing, the restoration that he has in mind, which I'm only a part of. And I get excited for what God wants to do. But I'm obedient in this thing that he has given me. I don't need to do the whole. I can't fill every seat here. I can fill one seat. I can do what God has told me to do. Be obedient in that. See, God allowed for his brothers to throw me into a pit, not to reveal their heart unto God. God knew what was stirring in their heart. He knew he's God. He allowed for it to happen so that in time their hearts will be revealed unto themselves. So God allows us to do stuff. He says, okay. And in time, our own hearts are revealed to us. When they came before Joseph and they realized that God was at work, even though they tried to work against it, God was at work, and suddenly they realized this was God, that what was in their heart came forward, and suddenly they became aware of God, his presence, his greatness, his sovereignty, and their nonsense. And repentance comes in. True repentance. See, true repentance comes in when we see God for who he is, when we come into his presence and we become aware of God, His love for me, His compassion for me. And I become aware of the sin in my life, the things that stand in the way. That's where I fall face down before God, and He comes with a father's embrace, not with a father's clap. He comes with that father's embrace, and it causes this heart of stone to break in a million pieces, and life starts to seep back. His life, that which He brings. I just want to touch on this thing of repentance. See, restoration and repentance, it's part and parcel. It's part of the whole thing. I cannot expect restoration if I'm not repentant because of the stuff I did that brought me into the situation. There needs to be repentance. Healing and repentance. There's so much that are interwoven into repentance. But I sometimes fear that it's something we just use as a recipe to get that which I want. Because I know this is part of the thing. So I use it. It's not a hard thing, but I do it. And I expect this thing that I want. And it's nothing but a transaction. The Bible speaks about it as prostitution. And, you know, sometimes in my best intentions, I really try to bring conviction to someone, but I can't. It's what the Holy Spirit does. Sometimes we go around and we so honestly want to do it, but we're trying to do the work of the Holy Spirit. And all we call to do is to take people into the presence of God. We bring them with us. We say, just feast your eyes on God. Who He is, experience His love. And as you experience His love, which you don't deserve, suddenly the Holy Spirit starts to work. It's the goodness of God. See, and I'm going off in a little bit of a different direction, but I mean, I came to Christ as a 10-year-old boy in the midst of a revival. And the scripture that God gave me that first day I came to Him, He gave me John 14:12, that we will do as Christ did, and we will do even more than that. And it was such a yes, you know. And I've been chasing after it. And I've seen so much of what God has done. So many miracles in people's lives, in my own life. But recently, it's like God just had me step back a bit, and He just said, Meiring, are you chasing something or someone? What is this thing that you're running after? Because, I mean, I desire to see the eyes of the blind open, the lame walk, the dead being resurrected, the power of the Holy Spirit at work. I desire to see that. But it's like God just questioned my intentions in wanting to see it. He said there's no good in running after something, a wave that takes you up, you enjoy the ride, and it leaves you on the sand exactly where you were yesterday. There's no permanent effect into the kingdom of God with this thing. There's no greater purpose for this thing. And I had to step back and I'd say, okay, Lord. And He even said, there's no use running after me. Because Scripture says, abide in me. You are in Christ now. That's what Scripture says. You are in Christ. He said, Meiring, stay in me. Just abide in me. Don't run ahead. We so easily want to run ahead. We get excited about something and off we go. But if we can just stay with a rhythm, His rhythm, sometimes it will pick up and we need to stay with Him. And sometimes He'll slow down. Can we hear that voice? John Piper's got this quote. He said, God is most glorified in and through us when we are most satisfied in Him. God is most glorified in and through us when we are most satisfied in Him. Nothing else matters more than just being in His presence. That's where His Holy Spirit starts to work. And that's where He will be glorified in it. See, we can't be after the works. will be good, but it will still leave us unfulfilled and unsatisfied to our way. It might not glorify, it might glorify him, but there's a danger in it. But it's when we find ourselves in his presence. So I need to get back to where we were going. See, I believe true restoration, true healing, true revival empties out prisons and hospitals. It establishes God's principles and government offices. It raises up nations at bread baskets in times of famine, impacting nations around them. It has a permanent exponential effect of ushering in the blessing of God's kingdom of peace, joy, love, providence in our city, providence in our nation, to the nations around us, to the world. That's the thing of either I'm looking through it like this and it's all about me, or I realize what God's heart is in restoration. See, not only does God restore Joseph, but as we said, he restores the family. That family were more wholesome afterwards than before. Before, Joseph was full of arrogance and pride. He was immature. The brothers had hatred towards him in their heart. They were a family. They could all smile and we'd say, "Ah, oh, that's such a pretty family." But afterwards, when God had taken them through this process and he had restored them, they were much more wholesome family, the way God intended it to be. And not just a family, but he drew a nation unto himself, and he provided for nations in that time of famine. So let's move on to the last one. It's the parable of the embracing father and the prodigal son. Luke 15 from verse 17. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death. I'll set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and I've sinned against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called a son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For the son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate." For me, that's just such a beautiful picture of restoration. Such a beautiful picture of me and you. It's a picture of mercy and grace. Mercy. Not receiving that which I deserve. Can I say it again? Mercy. Not receiving that which I deserve. I deserve a clap. I deserve to be a slave unto death, but it passes me by because of the blood of the Lamb. Only because of him passes me by. I don't get what I deserve. Grace. I receive a ring that reinstates my sonship. That ring, it's a father's ring. When he said, put a ring on him, it's from his house, it's from the father's house, it's his ring. It's a father's ring. It says, I belong to the father now. It almost gives me the father's authority now. I don't deserve it. I didn't earn it, but he gives it. And then that robe of mercy and grace. The father, bring a robe. It's the father's robe. And I picture it as this red, big robe that covers you from the head to your feet. And it covers all that filth of his clothes from the pigsty and where he's been. It covers him. It covers all of that. All of the past. It covers it. And as the father looks at him, all he sees is this red robe. As the father looks at us, all he sees is the blood of Jesus over us. And he says, you're my son. You're mine. You're mine now. I've reinstated you. I receive an eternal inheritance despite my sin. I receive him as a counselor, comforter, and friend. You remember Job's friends? They were friends, comforters, and counselors, but now we receive the true comforter and counselor. We receive the Holy Spirit. He allows us to receive his Spirit. Amazing. I'm empowered by his Spirit now, despite my best works being nothing but a filthy stream. He allows me to have his Spirit. Two things I just quickly want to look at. The one is money. Money didn't corrupt a young man. It only revealed that which was already at work within him. There was something already at work within him, and when he got his portion, his wealth, it only revealed it. It revealed those deeper, almost demons lurking within him. If I have pride, I'll probably become a pain in the butt if I have money. If I'm stingy, I'll lose my mind trying to just be in control of every penny out there. If I have a problem with lust, the chances are that I'll end up divorced if suddenly I have a great amount of wealth. If I'm manipulating, chances are that I'll become a big bully. But to the other side as well, if I have a heart to bless, I'll bring joy and relief to thousands. If I'm creative, I'll create opportunities for thousands. If I'm a leader, I'll become an agent of change. If I have a heart for the kingdom of God and for the lost, I'll enable the evangelists to run wild and run ablaze. I'll enable the shepherds to disciple well. That is the other side. Complete restoration. And I'm not talking about tithes and offerings now. It will be like looking through this thing again. Because everything belongs to God. Everything's God's. But the question is, have we allowed this process within us of restoration, of us becoming safe stewards for what he wants to deposit, for what he wants to do? God restores the whole. He restores body, spirit, and soul, the whole. Not just the hand, but the foot as well. Not just the eye, the ear, everything, the whole. And that includes financial restoration to the body of Christ. I believe this is not prosperity preaching or something, but it's part of restoration, which I believe. That as we enter into a season of restoration, we will see God restoring to the body that which is due the body. Then we look at the brother, me and you, and the Pharisees. The law commands you, my brother, to have the fatherly slap. We so earnestly want him to have that. How can you just embrace him, Father? See, for some reason, Jesus stopped short of telling us what happened the next day. What happened on the farm further on? I think he knew we would take it and we'd become legalistic and all religious about it, and we'll treat everyone according to what happened on the farm. I'm sure the young man had to rise up 5 o'clock the next morning after the party with his families and the servants and go back to work on the farm. I'm sure he got the tractor without the canopy, without the aircon, and I'm sure he had to plow the biggest land that day. And I'm sure he had to wash the tractors, all of them, by himself that month, just to get to know what they look like, what they smell like, what they feel like, the different parts, because it's to his good. But he did it with such a big smile, all because of that father's embrace, which he did not earn. He had such gratitude, such thankfulness, such love for the Father. You see, that embrace reinstated the true Son, the one who knew his Father, who loved him, who wanted to honor him, who wanted to be at the work of his Father, who understood this inheritance he had. We talk about a fatherless generation a lot these days. We look at Namibia, we look at Africa, we look at the world, and it's evident. You see, the world is trying to get rid of God, our Creator, and God, our Father, for the reason. Because if they can get rid of God, the Creator, and the Father, where are we stuck? we come from him, we belong to him. So if they can do that, suddenly my design, how am I supposed to understand my design if there's no designer anymore? If there's no one I can go to for the blueprint to say, Lord, how should I understand myself, where I fit in? Sometimes we like these bricks that try to be the window and the window that try to be the door. But we have a Father. We can go to him and say, God, where is it that you fit me in this season? You know? We've got such a privilege. And that's why the world wants to do away with him. Because if they can do that, then there's no purpose to my life. There's no destiny. There's no destination where we're heading towards. And if there's no destination, there's no responsibility on my side. No responsibility, no accountability, and that's fairly what we see going on in the world. So on Friday, I had a coffee with someone, and he spoke about just how God spoke to him through Genesis 2. He said he looked at this and creation and how God, as he finished creating everything, all the animals, all of it, how it's like he took Adam and he said, come here, my son. Look at what I've done. Look at what I've created. You know, just like so excited with his son. I want to show off what I did. Adam, but I want you to be part of it. I don't just want you to enjoy it, you and Eve. It's not just there for you to enjoy. I want you to have a part in it. You're going to rule over it. You're going to even name them. You have a part in this, Adam. Come, Adam. So excited about it. Can you just picture it? And the only thing, that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, we know what happened. There's more, Adam. There's more you can be like. And the serpent and the lies, and even Adam. And now we've got this creation ordinance that we reproduce. We can only reproduce that which God created us to be. Man, man, horses, horses, trees, trees. An ostrich doesn't hatch a litter of lion cubs because that design is faulty. They'll consume themselves. Therefore, sin reproduces sin. That's it. We were born into sin. Scripture is clear about that. Romans 5, Romans 3, there's so many scriptures. We were born into sin. We can only reproduce sin. But God, in his everlasting, this exponential love of his, he had a plan. It wasn't a plan B. Jesus was never a plan B. Jesus was never a plan to come and fix something. Scripture is clear. It says in John 1 that he was there in the beginning. In him all things hold together. He was the plan from the beginning. That we were given access to the Father again. After we were plucked away from his presence, we were left by ourselves. No hope, nothing we can do. God had this plan with Christ. And through him, we have access to the Father, into his presence again. We can be with him. We can be completely and utterly fulfilled. This restoration process can take place. And that's what we look forward to so much. So much. That's what we're part of now. That's what we're excited about. And we thank him for what he's busy doing. God's heart has always been and will always be set on restoration. It's a process that starts with us getting up and turning to the Father. That young man, he sat there, looked at everything, and he realized, all I can do is I need to get up, I need to go to the Father. And it says the Father ran to him. The Father ran to him. He didn't run to the Father. He just started going in that direction, and the Father ran to him. Such a beautiful picture. So as we end off, just quickly again, you know, Job endured a time of testing. He remained faithful to God, fearing God, being obedient to God, and it also went outward. He prayed with and for his friends. Can we, doesn't matter what our situation is, can we continue praying with each other, praying for each other, trusting God's work of restoration in ourselves, in this congregation, in all nations, in Windhoek, Namibia, out into the world? Joseph endured a time of testing until he was found to be a safe steward of what God wanted to do through him. Found to be safe. All of us, we're quick to put up our hands. Yes, Lord, use me. The question is today, am I safe for what God wants to do? Let me just continue faithfully in this process of God bringing restoration to me, understanding who I am, my identity in him. I am a son. And the prodigal son who got back up and turned to God. It's time for us to get up and return to God. I'm going to end it off here. And there's more restoration now happening. It's beautiful. We've got a baptism that's going to take place now. And it's so beautiful. It feels like it's perfect to end off today speaking about restoration. It's part of this restoration. It's like the sealing coming back to Christ.